Earth is the only planet that we know of that has both active plate tectonics and extant or living life.
But is this a coincidence, or is plate tectonics required for life, or vice versa?
I just recently posted a video about the link between mountains and life, and how life throughout Earth's history has contributed to mountain formation, and I'll link that video up to the top right for you if you're interested in learning how that works and why. But one of the questions that came up while discussing that in that video was the fact that Earth is the only planet that we know of that has both plate tectonics and life. And so is there a link between plate tectonics itself and life rather than just mountain building and life? And does this mean that life requires plate tectonics or vice versa? And you might think, wait a second, other planets and moons have mountains and tectonic features on their surfaces, but these planets and moons, yes, have tectonics, but they don't have global plate tectonics. I also have a video talking about the difference between tectonics and plate tectonics and how plate tectonics, tectonics involving global lithospheric plates, is just one type of tectonic regime. And so I'll link that video up to the top right for you as well. In any case, other planets and moons, at least that we know of, don't have global tectonic plates like Earth does. And many geoscientists actually think that this isn't a coincidence, that plate tectonics has helped drive evolution and sustain life on Earth. But how? What is this link between plate tectonics and life? One thing that's clear is that liquid water seems to be necessary for both life and plate tectonics, at least based on how they operate on Earth. In terms of life, water is one of the main ingredients that life needs, at least life as we know it, needs to live. And while most other rocky planets and moons have the other ingredients for life in some capacity, or most if not all of them, which includes the CHNOPS elements, carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, phosphorus, and sulfur, liquid water, liquid H2O, is rare in our solar system, at least on planet and moon surfaces. Yes, there are some moons of Saturn and Jupiter that literally have liquid water oceans beneath an icy crust that contain more water than all of Earth does in many cases. This liquid water is in their subsurface, not their surface. And having stable bodies of liquid water at a planet or moon's surface is really helpful for sustaining life on that planet or moon, which is why Earth is ideal. And I'll talk more about that later, but in any case, the point is here, liquid water is necessary for life. But what about water's tie to plate tectonics? How does water drive plate tectonics? Well, first let's talk about the timing at which water, liquid water, first formed on Earth's surface, and then plate tectonics began, and then we'll talk about the link between the two. So Hadean-aged zircons, or minerals that are dated to over 4 billion years old, suggest that water was present on Earth as early as 4.4 billion years ago. But at first, for a long time, water was mainly present as just vapor on Earth because Earth was so hot in the beginning stages of its formation. And as it cooled down, it eventually cooled to a global average below water's boiling point, which allowed for liquid water to begin accumulating at its surface. This happened around 3.8 billion years ago in the Archean Eon, and continued degassing of water vapor from Earth's interior to the surface, in other words, continued release of water vapor from the mantle of Earth, which contained hydrous minerals that were melting and going into magma and then exploding out of volcanoes, which was degassing all sorts of volatiles from that magma, including water and other things that formed Earth's early atmosphere. This degassing process led to an abundance of water vapor in the atmosphere, which eventually condensed as Earth cooled to form rain and eventually fill up vast oceans beginning around 3 billion years ago. And global plate tectonics is thought to have begun around 2.5 billion years ago. Yes, that's right. Even Earth, just like those other planets we talked about that had tectonics, just not plate tectonics, even Earth had
periods in its past, from 4.5 to 2.5 billion years ago, in which its tectonic regime was not plate tectonics. It didn't have global lithospheric plates that were moving around on the asthenosphere. It had tectonics, but not plate tectonics just yet. But the transition to plate tectonics occurred around 2.5 billion years ago, right after oceans began forming on Earth. So is this a coincidence? Or did water somehow play a part in driving Earth's transition to global plate tectonics? Well, we don't think that it was a coincidence. We think that, in fact, water did play a role because water lowers the strength and melting temperature of rocks, driving deformation and melting associated with plate tectonics. In fact, many geoscientists think that a planet is unlikely to develop plate tectonics if it doesn't have water. So water is required for both life and plate tectonics, but is plate tectonics required for life? Well, plate tectonics drives the cycling of water between Earth's surface and subsurface. How this cycle works is subducting plates, subducting oceanic crust plates, go down or subduct underneath continental plates because they're denser. And as they subduct down, they bring all these hydrous or water-containing minerals down into the mantle, which induces melting and then subsequent volcanism and water vapor release back to the surface. So there's this cycle of bringing water down into the mantle and then releasing it back to the surface system. And a lack of this plate tectonic driven water cycle from surface to subsurface might explain why other planets don't have abundant liquid water at their surfaces. On Earth, plate tectonics has been instrumental in creating liquid water bodies at Earth's surface that can support life. Not only through driving the release of water from the subsurface to the surface, but also through creating ocean basins and physical topographic regions and aquatic environments in which life can live. But wait a second, we just said earlier that plate tectonics didn't begin until around 2.5 billion years ago, whereas life evolved much sooner, around 3.5 to 4 billion years ago. So plate tectonics wasn't in fact necessary for life to evolve. It just helped later on to drive water cycling between the subsurface and surface and to create these types of environments. But it doesn't seem to have been necessary for life to evolve in the first place. But even if plate tectonics isn't linked to the origin of life on Earth, many geoscientists think that it contributed to evolution of higher life, like the first more complex cells or eukaryotes around 2 to 2.7 billion years ago, and the first multicellular life around 1 billion to 600 million years ago, depending on which group of organisms you're talking about. Multicellularity has evolved more than once. In any case, the beginning of plate tectonics seems to have lined up with either the appearance of eukaryotes or the evolution of multicellularity, depending on which timing of plate tectonics origin you go with. There are some scientists in the camp of it began around 2.5 billion years ago or even sooner, and some in the camp of it didn't really globally get started until 1 billion years ago. But either way, it's thought that plate tectonics somehow, some way, drove evolution forward to higher or more complex life. It not only did this through contributing to the water cycle we just talked about, but also plate tectonics redistributes continents, builds mountains, forms and breaks land bridges, and opens and closes ocean basins. This constant environmental change and pressure drives evolution. Two particular processes are really important for driving evolution, and that is the isolation of species, which is promoted by the separation of continents, continental breakup, which is driven by plate tectonics, and competition between species for similar niches, which is promoted by continental collision or land bridge formation, which allows species that live in similar niches to meet and compete. And plate tectonics has also caused mass extinction events, or contributed in large part to mass extinction events, which also greatly drive evolutionary advancement through opening a lot of new niches. And typically, after mass extinction events in Earth's past, we see even greater biodiversity, as shown in this chart, after mass extinction events than before. Plate tectonics has also caused global climate change, kind of in association with mass extinction events for the most part, but global climate change is another thing that drives evolution forward through changing environmental conditions to which species must adapt. So what does this mean for space exploration? If a world doesn't have plate tectonics, should we still look for life there? Well, again, while tectonic activity drives cycles like the water cycle from surface to subsurface, which helps sustain life on Earth, this tectonic activity doesn't have to involve plates. Worlds like Europa and Enceladus, moons of Jupiter and Saturn that have liquid water oceans and icy crusts, for example, don't have global plate tectonics, but they might still support life in their liquid water oceans, especially if they are tectonically active in some way, even if this tectonics doesn't involve plates. And if you've ever seen a picture of Enceladus or Europa, you know that they're tectonically active. I mean, look at the tectonic features on Europa's surface and the jets shooting out of Enceladus's south pole. They're clearly active tectonically, they just might not have a global tectonic plate system that drives their tectonics. But their tectonic regime still might drive enough cycling from surface to subsurface to sustain life in their oceans. So I hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you want to check out the recent video I did about the link between life and mountain building on Earth and how life has contributed to mountain formation throughout Earth's history, I will link that up on the screen somewhere for you. And with that, guys, my references are linked below as always. And I can't wait to see you guys in my next one. Bye.